Hey, honey, hey, which part of the church are you in, the left or the right? Well, it's a candlelight service. I gotta know where you're at.
Oh, ask her if my wife and kids are sitting up
there. Huh? You're wearing red and green and you're holding a candle. Great, I'll be able to spot you out immediately.
Ask her.
Huh? Oh, is Tommy's wife and kids with you? Yeah, there. Okay, all right, see you in a minute. Love you too, bye.
Are we late?
We were 15 minutes late 10 minutes ago. What do you think?
What I think is that Jesus is gonna like what I got him.
What do you mean?
It's his birthday.
And?
And I got him a present.
A present? What present? We don't need to give him gifts.
Really? You think we just show up, light a few sticks of wax, sing some songs, and call it good?
Well, the candlelight service isn't a birthday party. I mean, it's a time that we reflect on the birth of Christ. We light a candle as a message to the world that we believe that Christ will return one day. It's a light that dispels the darkness. We light a candle as a prayer that goes up to heaven that our hope burns bright. It's the true essence of Christmas.
Did you rehearse that? No thanks.
Did you hear what I said? We light the candle because...
Yeah, I heard you.
Well, then grab a candle.
I got my own. Happy birthday, Jesus.
You're not going to bring that in there.
Sure I am. I want everyone to know that I'm thankful that he came and I'm looking forward to his return.
That actually makes sense.
Who's not playing with a full deck now? Ow! Oh, the wax! I didn't think about the wax. It is so hot. I need something that I can... There we go. That's better. Merry Christmas.
Came to see Mary. She was doing laundry, and then the angel just appeared and she was really scared. So Gabriel was like, Mary, you're gonna have, what? I can't say it good. Mary, you're gonna have a baby. You're gonna have a baby and you will call him Jesus. And then Mary was like, I'm not gonna have a baby yet. I'm only a teenager and I'm not married. Then the angel Gabriel told Joseph that Mary is not lying. You are having a new baby. And so they met up. They went to Bethlehem, which was Joseph's old town.
They ride a donkey.
I don't know.
A camel.
Oh yeah, a camel. She said, this donkey's fast. They tried to go to a hotel and
they asked the keeper for a place to stay. The keeper said,
we have no rooms. Literally, no rooms.
So Mary and Joseph walked away sadly, but then he said,
the only place in here in Bethlehem that you can stay is a stable. And then he just pointed the way and they followed. When the shepherds were taking care of the sheep,
then they saw angels.
The angels said, a new baby is getting born, who is king of the Jews.
The angel were singing.
Glorious. And then the shepherds said, I think we should go there and meet him. The second, I think, said, yeah, I agree with you. And the other said, yeah, me too. They had to walk through a bunch of grass and bushes, maybe have to camp out a night. Then the wise men heard about it.
And then a star appeared.
We should probably follow that star. It's pointing down to the barn.
So maybe we should follow it. Maybe. So wise men went to Jesus.
They gave them gifts.
A stuffed animal, like a hippo one they have at home.
Some diapers, and some wipes, and some milk, some shoes, some Jordans.
Gold, ring, and Latimer.
And I don't know how I would survive in that barn. Too stinky, too crowded, and ugh.
I think he probably pooped because the room was very smelly. Thank you for coming.
He's adorable.
He's gonna be our best friend.
I love you, and you the best baby I ever seen. There, I said it.
The new baby is gonna change the world.
Good morning. So as I was up front praying, as I often do, asking for God's intervention on the message for you today, God's trying to tell me something, but I was busy praying. And you know, when you're talking, you're not listening. And God kept trying to tell me something, and then finally he said, "You're not wearing your microphone." I said, "Oh yeah." So that's where I was. So good morning, welcome, our fourth week of Advent. Today's theme is love. And I'm gonna tell you right now, I was gonna open the sermon with this, but I'm gonna tell you right now, God's been on my heart. After each message, I feel like it was incomplete. I feel like it just wasn't right. It wasn't what I prepared, it wasn't good enough. And what God put on my heart is that I am not telling all of you how much he loves you. Amen. Thank you. I love to go through the scripture, and to me, that is just so automatic to understand that God ever came into my life to begin with and loved me so much. But he's telling me that I need to remind all of you of that. You know, about all that he's done for you. He created you to be who you are, and he brought you here this morning to hear his word. Amen? So he loves you, and there's nothing you can do to make him love you any more or any less. And there's nothing that you have ever done that can disqualify you from God's love. Amen. So welcome this morning. Welcome, you know, bring your mess in here with you. and share with us. This is a sanctuary. This is a safe place. I know we get tired of hearing those words on the news, but what that means for us is that all we have is grace and forgiveness and love and patience for each other. Amen. We practice being Christians in here, so when we go out there and we get tested, we're ready to go. Right? Amen. Any announcements this morning? Un momento, Señor.
Where's Angela? Angela, can we? Who am I too close to?
Let me turn you off.
Could you come up here, please? You said it earlier in the spirit of love, we're in the theme of Advent, this fourth Advent in the Christmas season, the spirit of love. In response to that love and in the spirit of giving and giving back for the blessings we've received through you and Angela and through our Savior, the congregation has come together and wanted to give you both a Christmas present from all of us and just extend on behalf of everybody just the love we have for you and how blessed we are that both of you have joined us. So,
thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you. Yeah, I think we're the ones that are blessed, but wait a minute, baby. Because all husbands know how this goes, right? Thank you. I love this. All the wives smile knowingly. Any other announcements? Amy.
You want me to go up there?
Hey, you guys at home, God loves you too. Doesn't matter that you're not here, right? You ought to be here, but he loves you anyway.
So, for those, you're going to... I thought the picture was going to go up. But anyway, if you walk up here, because sitting way back there, you can't see it, there are 110 gifts around this organ, thanks to all of you. And that was taken before more came in.
There's like six more out here.
And there's more coming in. So, yes, come on in. I just want to say thank you to all of you who shopped, who chose something for someone who may not have had a Christmas otherwise. And I just want to say thank you. I'm sure they'll be very much appreciated. And Pastor is going to bless the gifts once they all get in here so we can send them off with God's love. Thank you.
Hey, so also, I sent an email out, but I know not everybody reads their emails as consistently as I read mine, but there's the United Methodist City Society, which I never paid a whole lot of attention to because it said City Society, and I'm about as far as you can get from the city right now, right? We're all that far. But it's an outreach unit, UMC outreach to all of the churches. It's not just in the city. And one of the things they're doing is very similar to this. And in the email I sent out yesterday, we're collecting money, and some of you have already donated to me, so God bless you. We're collecting money to buy gifts for children whose parents are incarcerated. Right? God tells us that we are to visit the sick and visit those in prison. Feed the hungry, clothe the naked, right? So as part of the prison ministry, and out on this end, Beach United Methodist Church of West Hampton is leading the charge. We're signed a whole bunch of cards. Thank you for those that signed them. We're going to bring the cards to the inmates. But in the meantime, for every $25 donation, a kid of an incarcerated person gets a gift. And regardless of what they did that got them in there, you know, we've all probably... If everything was known, I would have spent some time myself, but I'm not proud of it. And don't worry, that's a long time ago. Long time ago. But, you know, they are but for the grace of God, amen. And what I was considering is when one of the parents is incarcerated, imagine how difficult it is to finance your household. You've lost a source of income. Amen. So I love that. So if any of you have a heart to donate anything, I'm going to be bringing money over to Beach United Methodist Church today, as well as all the cards that were signed. All right. So if you will join me, just hold out your hands. We need a blessing on these gifts. So Heavenly Father, you've taught us, Lord, to look for the widows and the orphans and those on the fringe of society that are often forgotten because they can't get out, or some circumstance prevents them from being with us. And Lord, we know that there are many, many people that don't have all that you've blessed us with. And Lord, you said, to whom much is given, much is expected. So Lord, this is our offering to you, to all of those children, so that they know that your love is in the world and your love is working through your people, and that this may draw them closer to you, Lord, that one day they receive a blessing to be a blessing. So Lord, bless these gifts. May they go with all the love that was put into them when we shopped and wrapped them with special care, Lord, and let the joy, peace, hope, and love of this season fill these families when they receive these gifts. And we pray this in Jesus' precious name, and all God's children said, amen. 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 All right, God bless you all. Let's start the service with an opening hymn, and all of you can join with us. You may stand so you can open up that diaphragm, move that breakfast out of your way. Would you join me in the call to worship? Let us read. This is the fourth Sunday of Advent, a time to rejoice in the wondrous things that God is doing. Our hearts are filled with the hope that is coming into the world. The time is fast approaching, not for parties or presents, but for the awareness of God's loving gift to us, the gift of the Christ child. Help slow us down, Lord, that we may realize that your gift of love is at the center of our lives and our celebrations. Thanks be to God, who again reminds us of his eternal love. Open our hearts, O Lord, to receive your blessed gift. Amen. Amen. Now, remain standing. Where are you girls going? Oh, remain standing while we watch the video and sing along.
Jesus, Lord, at thy birth. Jesus, Lord, at thy birth. Oh, oh, oh.
Holy,
you are
holy.
Oh, yeah.
Home in a manger for you and for me.
Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless this assembly this morning, Lord. Bless all of us that have come here to worship your name, Lord, and to thank you for the greatest Christmas gift of all time, the most important event in human history. You're coming into this world to be with those that you love. Lord, may we feel your love, may we feel the presence of your Holy Spirit, and Lord, Mary, carry that love and light out into this world, Lord, to let everyone know that you are active. You are active through your people. And we pray all of this in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus. And all God's children said, amen. Amen. Now, we have the lighting of the Advent candle. And Bob is going to read a poem that he wrote especially for the occasion.
Is this on? Yes.
You
want to go around the other side?
Good morning. God is love, and we are created in God's image. Love came down at Christmas, goes the carol. Love all lovely, love divine. The first letter of John reads, in this the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. Jesus told his friends that love is not to be limited to God. Love one another, even as I have loved you. The first candle of our wreath represents our hope in God's promise of a Savior. The second candle signifies the peace that Christ brings to earth. We celebrate the joy that God gives to us in the coming of the Messiah as we light the third candle. The fourth candle completes our Advent circle and lifts up the down-to-earth love of God. We light this candle both to proclaim God's love for a broken world and also to remember that because God first loved us, we are called to love one another. Like love, this candle, in order to shed its light, must give itself away. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you that you have not remained distant and removed from our lives, but came as one of us to share our burdens and our delights. As we prepare again to celebrate the birth of Jesus, help us to shed the light of your love to others, especially to those who feel unloved and unwanted. Amen.
Two weeks ago, you know, I asked some of the kids to come up and explain to them in Sunday school that God has been calling for a long, long time, from the beginning of time. And so we went to go back in the Bible and find out who he was calling, because this is really an end of one story and the beginning of another. So when we opened the gift that I had brought in, inside was this map. And on the top of it, it says, God speaks. And it began in the Garden of Eden. And we talked about how Adam and Eve fell from God. And then God spoke to Noah. And Noah was a man of righteousness and his family. So God said, even though we've fallen short of the mark, I am not going to destroy my people yet. So he told Noah to build the ark. And Noah listened and built the ark. And then after that, the people once again fell from the grace of God. And they went down. But he wasn't done yet. So he called Moses. And Moses brought the slaves out of Egypt. And then he parted the Red Sea. And then we started to slip again. But God spoke to Isaiah. And he spoke about a new beginning and a new life. And that's where we begin this time. It's like, this is not the end of a story here. This is the beginning, where God doesn't want us going up and down and up and down. He wants us to stay on a path. And so he brought us Jesus, who leads that path for us. And so, as children of God, we keep on keeping on. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
And if there's any kids that want to go into Sunday school, I'll take them.
Let us read. Compassionate God, you gather the whole universe into your radiant presence and continually reveal your Son as our Savior. Bring wholeness to all that is broken and speak truth to us in our confusion, that all creation will see and know your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. 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 I don't know how many of you do devotionals, but I would recommend that all of you do devotional, morning devotionals. This morning, I have a sermon all planned and written out, but God gave me this psalm this morning, and I just want to read it to you real quick. Preserve me, this is Psalm 16. Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no God apart from you. As for the saints in the land, that would be all of you. They are the excellent ones in whom is all my delight. The sorrows of those who run after another god shall multiply. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names on my lips. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me. I have set the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand, and I shall not be shaken. Therefore my heart is glad, and my whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure, for you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, or let your Holy One see corruption. You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Amen? Amen. It's such an encouraging word. Sometimes, you know, the world's just beating you down, and it's so good to get into God's word and have him speak directly to you. Amen? Let me take this off, because I think I'm at a safe distance from all of you. There's too many things hanging on my ears. There's hearing aids, there's a microphone, there's a mask, and everything gets out of place. So God speaks directly to us through the scriptures. Amen? So, Bob, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to wake you up. I'm teasing. Bob, did you know that God's love is perfect and that it's a model for how we should love? Amen. In 1 Corinthians 13, verses 4 and 7, it says, love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist in its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Amen? Now, this is my first time making a PowerPoint for the scripture, and I've just learned I need to make the fonts bigger. I'll work on that. You hear that reading a lot at weddings, and you think that that's written for a couple getting married to make sure that they love one another. Amen? But that was not written for a wedding. That was not written for a wedding. The same as joy to the world was not written for Christmas. This was an everyday instruction that Paul was giving to Christians in a church that had a lot of dissension. And he was explaining to them, no. You love each other, just what he said. We're patient. We're patient with each other. We're kind. Amen? And we don't boast. We're not irritable. That's a difficult one for a lot of us. We're not irritable. We're not resentful. I was going to do that, or I was going to. Amen? We learn to let that go. This is the sanctuary where we practice all these things so that we're fit for the world. Tom, did you know, no, not you, Tom, I have another one for you. Tom Charles, did you know that when you fully experience God's love that you have nothing to fear? I know you know that, but in 1 John 4:18 it reads, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, for fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not yet been perfected in love. Amen? Patty, did you know that you are secure in your relationship with God? Did you know that nothing can separate you from God's love? Can anything in Romans 8, 35, 37 through 39 says, can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity, or are persecuted or hungry, or destitute, or in danger, or threatened with death? No. Despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us. And I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow, Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below. Indeed, nothing at all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen? Amen. Friend, just because you're sitting right here in front, right? Did you know that God's love is too great for us to even understand? Absolutely. In Ephesians, we hear, "And may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, and how deep his love is. May you experience the love of Christ, though it is too great to understand fully. Then you will be made complete with all the fullness of life and power that comes from God." Janet, did you know that God's love is a shield surrounding you and keeping you safe? Amen. In Psalm 5, we read, "But let all who take refuge in you rejoice. Let them sing joyful praises forever. Spread your protection over them, that all who love your name may be filled with joy. For you bless the godly, O Lord. You surround them with your shield of love." All right, Tom, now I'll pick on you just to get you out of the way. Did you know that God will not let you down because his love cannot fail? Amen. We read in Psalm 36, "Your unfailing love, O Lord, is as vast as the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches beyond the clouds. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains. Your justice like the ocean depths. You care for people and animals alike. O Lord, how precious is your unfailing love. Oh God, all humanity finds shelter in the shadow of your wings." Who shall I pick on? Nancy, did you know that God calls you his child? He does. In 1 John, we read, "See how very much our Father loves us, for he calls us his children, and that is what we are. But the people who belong to this world don't recognize that we are God's children, because they don't know him. But we do, amen?" Derek. Derek says, "I sat in the back. I learned from going to comedy clubs, never sit in the front." But Derek, did you know God chose to adopt you because he loves you? Amen. In Ephesians, it says, "God decided in advance to adopt us into his holy family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do, and it gave him great pleasure." Amen. Debbie. This Debbie. "God loves you so much that he sacrificed his son for you." John 3:16, "For this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only son so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life." And 3:17 says he did not come into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world. Amen. Sandy, God loved you enough to die for you even when you were rebelling against him. Actually, I should have called on myself for that one. In Romans 5:8, it says, "But God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were yet sinners." Amen? God's love was working in my life before I ever knew him. I mean, really knew him. I knew of him, but now, praise God, I've got to know him. Paulo, you can never earn or deserve the love that God gives you. In Ephesians again, it says, "But God is so rich in mercy, and he loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you have been saved." Amen. Amen. Rusty, God's love allows you to change and grow into the person that he wants you to be. Amen. And I know you have experienced that, as is our prayer for everyone to experience to accept God's love, to grow into the person that he wants you to be. In Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, either way, Christ's love controls us. Since we believe that Christ died for all, we also believe that we have died to our old life. He died for everyone so that those who receive his new life will no longer live for themselves. Instead, they will live for Christ, who died and was raised for them. Amen. I'm going to run out of names. I'm just going to go ahead and read through these because I don't want to make any more of you uncomfortable. This is for all of you. Did you know that God gives us his Holy Spirit because he wants us to be filled with his love? Amen. God's Holy Spirit, when we receive his Spirit, when we are baptized in the Holy Spirit, that's when everything begins. Amen. That's the spark that ignites the fire. That's what opens up our hearts and God starts pouring his love into us. Amen. And I promised myself I would not sermonize. I would just read scriptures. So let me read this scripture from Romans again. And this hope will not lead to disappointment, for we know how dearly God loves us because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. Now, if you're thinking some of these scriptures sound a little unusual to you, I want to explain, and for those of you that are in a Bible study, you've heard this already. There are many translations of the Bible. The translations I usually use is the English Standard Version, which is kind of a middle-of-the-road translation. A lot of you are familiar with the NIV, but there's two types of translations. One is a direct translation, and one is a paraphrasing. I'm using paraphrasing translations today. In other words, they don't go word for word and try to reproduce what the original writer put down in Greek or Hebrew or Aramaic. What they do is they read the text and then they give it to us in our language, all right? So this isn't a direct translation, but I think for a lot of us it's more accessible, okay? And it doesn't change the meaning of God's word. It's just the language, right? Besides, God wants us to show that we're Christians by our actions, not by our words. For all of you, God disciplines you to help you learn because he loves you. In Proverbs, my child, don't reject the Lord's discipline and don't be upset when he corrects you. For the Lord corrects those he loves, just as a father corrects a child in whom he delights. Amen. For all of you again, God cares when you're suffering. He does. Sometimes we feel all alone in our suffering. But God cares for you when you're suffering because he loves you. Psalm 31, I will be glad and rejoice in your unfailing love, for you have seen my troubles, and you care about the anguish of my soul. In the Old Testament, they wrote about God, you've seen my troubles. This is what we know, that God came to earth, the incarnation, which is what we're celebrating in this season, amen? God came to earth in human form. For two reasons. One, so that we can see him and know him, so that we can wrap our minds around him. Amen. We have the words of Christ. We have the actions of Christ. This we understand. A God that's beyond time and space, sometimes it's difficult for us to accept, to fully understand and accept that he even knows what I'm going through. Right? How does a God beyond time and space know what it feels like to get a bad report from a doctor? Well, God solved that problem by coming to earth as Christ Jesus and experienced everything we experienced. Amen? Loss of friends, illness, hunger, everything we've been through, Christ has been through. So God understands our plight, and God loves us, and he's with us in our troubles. And even when things seem hopeless, you can hope. That's something, one of those candles we lit. We can hope because we know God loves us. We're reminded of this in Lamentations. I will never forget this awful time as I grieve over my loss. Yet I still dare to hope when I remember this. The faithful love of the Lord never ends. His mercies never cease. Great is his faithfulness. His mercies begin afresh each morning. And in Bible study, we've discovered the roots of so many hymns. Amen. As we read through the Psalms, and there's another one. Great is thy faithfulness. God is loving. Here's something other people have trouble with. He does not want to harm you. but to show you compassion. A lot of times when we were reading the book of Job, which not too many people in here were in that study, Job is going through a lot of suffering, and his friends came to be with him, and his friends were explaining, well, you must have done something to tick God off for all this to be happening to you. But the whole purpose of the book of Job is to remind us that that's not the case. That's not the case at all. Just because things are not going our well has nothing to do with how God feels about us. God always loves us. Amen? And he reminds us, we are in the world. So because we are in the world, we're going to experience everything that the world experiences. Amen? It rains on the just and the unjust. We're going to get sick, and we're going to die one day. We're going to have friends break our hearts. We're going to have all these calamities happen to us, just like everybody else. But there's a difference. We're in the world, but we are not of the world. So we know that when we trust in God, everything we go through, God is going to use it in our life to make us greater. Amen? That we love him. And I know I'm not walking through this alone. I know God is there holding me up, walking me through the fire, walking me through the flood, so that I come out on the other end. Amen? And in what many people consider the worst case scenario, for a lot of us, it's the payoff. When this body gives out, I'm going home to be with the Lord. Amen. I will never forget, try not to get choked up, my grandmother, my maternal grandmother, planted the seeds of faith in my life when I didn't even know that I was having seeds planted in me. Well, I grew very close, well, I was always close to her, mainly because she made these amazing biscuits. That was my first attraction as a kid. But when I came to Christ, my love for her deepened to a level I never understood. And I would talk to her on the phone frequently. She lived in North Carolina, and I was up here raising children, so I didn't have a whole lot of time to see her. And then one day she called me. She was in her 90s. And one day she called me, and as we were talking, she said to me, I'm tired, and I just want to go home. And she passed away shortly after that. But she had so much peace in her situation. You know, she was in her 90s, so she had osteoarthritis, she had all the problems that we get when we get older. And she just said, I'm tired of this fight. I just want to go home and be with the Lord. And I've heard that several times from other people. And I pray that I have that peace when my time comes. Jesus' love is an example of what it means to sacrifice and serve others out of love. And here is your example, amen. And you all deserve commendation. And this is just one thing. And I want you to be honest with me. How many of you felt great joy as you were picking out presents from the list? How many of you were experiencing, amen, that's how God makes us, amen? He makes us that way. And I might end up with that bicycle before it's over. You're not a kid anymore. Not physically, but emotionally, I'm still a child. God wires us that way. And me personally, I spent the first part of my life trying to fill my own cup, doing for me what made me happy. And I'm like a hamster in a wheel. You know, I'm constantly looking for the next thing. You know, let me go to the bar and see what the boys are doing. Let me do this, let me do that, let me buy myself a boat, let me do all these things to make myself happy. But for some reason, the happiness was only temporary. And then I was right back, and I had to go out and find something else. Because that's not how God made us. And then when God came into my life, he taught me, and we're still working on this, we're still perfecting this, he taught me to look at others and be concerned for others. And I discovered that magic pill, if you will, made me feel so much better, because so many things happen. One, I just naturally, we're wired to feel better when we help somebody, but it also takes our minds off of our condition. Amen? And I don't need to tell everybody how good I am or anything like that. You wait for others to tell you. You know, don't bang your own drum. Don't beat your own drum. God loves you, and God will make sure that he raises you up. What did Jesus say? When you come into a banquet, don't sit at the head of the table. Sit all the way in the back. Because if anything happens, they'll come and say, no, 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 and they'll bring you to the front, in front of everybody. He says, if you go and sit at the front, what may happen is they might come and say, excuse me, that's not for you, and move you to the back. And that was his lesson for us, not to be so prideful, to be humble. Amen. So Jesus' love is an example of what it means to sacrifice and serve others. And Jesus himself said this in the Gospel of John. Jesus knows that the Father has given him authority over everything, and that he had come from God and would return to God. So he got up from the table, took off his robe, wrapped a towel around his waist, and poured water into a basin. Then he began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with the towel he had around him. So now I am giving you a new commandment. Love each other just as I have loved you. You should love each other. Amen. And what an amazing example that was of Christ, the Messiah, getting on his knees to wash the feet of the disciples. We will never attain the perfection of Jesus in this life, but our goal is always to draw closer to that. Amen. God is love, so our love for others points to him. The first thing I wrote in a book that I made for children in Sunday school, you know, to try to understand who God is, when they opened the book, the first page just had three words: God is love. That's how it starts. That's how I wanted the kids to understand that. So that means when we love somebody else, that's God coming through us to somebody else, and that's how it works. We feel God's love. There's no way we can contain God's love, so we share it. And that's how people see God. That's how people see Christ in us. Amen? And that draws them to the light. And finally, because God loves us so much, his love should overflow from us into others, which is what I just said. And that was reminded to us in Galatians by Paul when he said, "But the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things." I don't know how many of you realize this, but I just read you the fruits of the Spirit. When you abide in Christ, you bear fruit. Amen? Think of Christ's example of a limb. We're surrounded by vineyards here, and this is what Jesus was talking about, because at that time they were surrounded by vineyards, and Jesus says, look, the branch cannot produce fruit unless it is attached to the vine. Jesus is the vine. His love flows into us, and then we produce fruit. And this is our fruit. And this is what everybody should see from us. Practice it here. Perfect it here with each other. So I'm going to go over it again. Love. Don't tolerate. Don't tolerate. Which is a good start, by the way. It's a good start. Tolerate somebody. But as you're tolerating them, ask God, because this is where it's going to come from. It's not going to come from you. Ask God, Lord, give me the compassion to love this person, not just tolerate. Because when you're tolerating me, I can tell. Right? You've all been there. I want genuine love. So ask God for that. Joy. Stop pursuing happiness. Again, ask God, Lord, fill me with the joy in all things. And what you're going to do, what that'll do for you, I promise you. I often say my transformation, in Paul, he said something like scales fell from his eyes. And that's how I feel like. Something fell from my eyes, and all of a sudden I could see things that I could never see before. And what I was seeing was giving me joy. Amen? Things that I missed. Things that God puts in our life to keep us joyful, I was not seeing because I was looking elsewhere. I was looking for myself mostly. Peace. Oh, this is a biggie. Peace. Have peace in all things. When you start to feel upset, and it's hard to say this to people that suffer from anxiety, and we all do from time to time, but anxiety is a lack of faith. And Jesus said that. Trust in me, lean on me, and he will give you that peace. It all comes from him. And here's a big one that my children wished I was saved many years earlier. Patience. Amen? Patience. Patience with you. Somebody says something, don't react. They say something like, I can't believe you wore that tie today. What tie would you like me to wear? You know, just take a second. And think, don't be so reactive. I was always very reactive. Ben, you say something, you bit me, I bit you right back, right? God has taught me, take a moment, take a breath, think of me, and then offer your reply. Kindness, amen, you guys got that down. Goodness, faithfulness. Be faithful to your word. Be faithful to God. Be faithful to your partner. Gentleness. Let's be gentle with each other. Amen. I mean, it's tough out there. We go out there and as things happening, this is where we come to get a hug, to get a smile, to get a pat on the back. I mean, I know there's social distancing, but I'm a touch guy. You know, I'm used to touching people, and I want to put my arm around them and hug them, and a gentle word. Amen. Let us be the balm of Gilead. When you come here, there's so many things are happening to us out. We come here for a smile and a kind word. Amen. And finally, self-control. And I'm still working on that one. So these are the fruits of the Spirit. And this is an example of God's love for us. Amen. This is an example of your love for people that you don't even know. And this is exactly how it should work. All right. And my fervent hope is just by reading the scripture, I wanted to read so much of God's word that it would affect you. My prayer this morning was, Lord, may your word reach the person that you intended it to reach today. And I pray that your heart was open, that one of these scriptures was particularly for you, just like that Psalm 16 was for me this morning. And if you don't have a daily devotional, I encourage you strongly, please get a daily devotional that you can read in the morning before you go out into that nasty world, right? Before you go out, before you even have that, some of you are going to say, oh no, before you even have that cup of coffee in the morning, before you check your phone for your Facebook hits or anything, Lord, please, before you look at the news, get into a devotional. If you don't understand devotionals or how they work, talk to me. Ladies, Angela has a terrific devotional called First Five, which is written specifically for women. First Five is the first 5 minutes of the day you give to the Lord in His Word so that He can fill you, all right? He knows what you're going to deal with that day. God knows what's waiting outside that door, and you don't yet, but God knows, and He's got a word for you to help you with that. Amen? And He's got a word for you to help you with that. Amen? Amen. Amen. One thing God made me was stubborn. So, accept this prayer. Heavenly Father, in this Christmas season, Lord, we're just overwhelmed by the love for us. Who are we that you would leave your place in heaven, your throne in heaven, and come down as a helpless little child, not as a king in glory, a great warrior, but a helpless little child, just as we were brought into this world. And you grew and dealt with everything that we dealt with, but you were perfect. And you sacrificed all that you had for each one of us. What amazing love is this, that you would give your life for me, for each of us. Lord, may we be so overwhelmed by your steadfast desire to bring us closer to you, that we submit, that we allow you to be the lords of our life, knowing that you care so much for us, that you want us to have an abundant life filled with the fruits of the Spirit, so that we can have all the peace, love, joy, and hope that comes with being an adopted child of the God of the universe. Lord, we love you this Christmas, and we pray that you bring all of us one step closer to you, Lord. No, two steps closer to you, Lord. Keep us ever walking towards your glorious light. Let this congregation grow and be such a bright light in this community that people cannot help but notice how you're working in our lives. Lord, make me more of a Christian, Lord. Make me more faithful, that I might have a more abundant life, more of all that you've given to me, Lord, and praise your holy name. And may that be the prayer of everyone gathered here today in your name. Lord, we love you for all you've done in our lives, Lord. We love you for what you are doing in our lives today. But most of all, Father, we love you for what you are going to be doing in our lives. And we pray all of this in the greatest Christmas gift ever known, our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus. And all God's children said, amen. Amen. Now, will you join us in our response to the word, which is a hymn called In the Bleak Midwinter. Step. Mm-hmm.
please join me in a prayer of confession? We pray corporately, and then I'll give you a moment to offer up your own prayer.
It starts, Jehovah Rapha. That's the God who provides. Amen. Jehovah Rapha, often I am not patient or kind, and I have envied others and boasted about myself. I have been arrogant and rude at times. I have been known to insist on my own way and to get irritable and resentful when that doesn't happen. I have also rejected at the failings of others. I've also rejoiced at the failings of others. I pray you forgive and heal me to love like you, Adonai. Amen. Take this moment to offer up your own prayers of confession. And I'll start with confessing and asking for forgiveness for not turning off my microphone before singing. You didn't deserve that. Offer your prayers. Amen. Hear these words of assurance. Hear the good news. God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. If you are in Christ, I know that his love controls us. Believe also that through him we have all died to our old life. He died for us all so that those who receive his new life will no longer live for themselves. Instead, they will live for Christ, who died and was raised for them. If you have received the Holy Spirit through trust in Christ, you are forgiven. And if you haven't, he loves you anyway and wants you to come to him. Amen? Amen. Amen. Now, while you're standing, join us in singing, I Wonder as I Wander. That's just us. Yes, just us. So sit and relax and enjoy as we sing, I Wonder as I Wander. And I wonder why, after all these months, the pastor still doesn't know.
Thank you. accept this benediction. Heavenly Father, your love for us is so apparent. Your love for us overflows. Lord, may your love fill us. May we allow ourselves to open up to allow your love to fill us so that we may be a vessel of love for each other and for a world that so desperately needs your love. Go out into the world and be that love for others. Amen. Experience God's love more fully. The more love you give, the more love you will receive. Be blessed until God brings us back together in his holy name. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now for our dismissal hymn. Now we can stand, right?
Yes.
Stand and join with us singing our closing hymn, Infant, Holy Infant, Lowly. Be seated. I've already offered the benediction.